Hello and welcome to this thermodynamics course. If you don't know me, obviously I teach thermodynamics. I also teach some other things on this channel. And the goal of this is to kind of get you to have a, you know, a baseline solid understanding of what thermodynamics is. I have other videos up on this channel, so please feel free to check those out. And a lot of them revolve around thermodynamics. I have some advice that I want to give before diving into the topic. And that is, please take a look at the descriptions in the videos. You know, sometimes I'll go through videos and I'll see the comments and somebody will say, hey, I think you made an error here, and I'll add the correction to the comments. So please do your due diligence to take a look at the comments. I think the next thing you might need is, and yeah, I have Mountain Dew, but there's a reason I have that, but is a good thermodynamics book. And I think this is the one that I used for Thermo 2, but it doesn't have to be this book, right? You know, this, you can just use this to follow along with what I'm saying, but really, most thermodynamic books should be the same. And I want to point out that I'm taking this at a macroscopic level, which means that I'm not getting into the little nitty-gritty, you know, molecules when we're dealing with thermodynamics, because you can, you know, examine things on that level, but that's not what this is. So it's a macroscopic, wide view, if you will, large overview, if you get what I'm saying. Another thing I'd like to encourage is feel free to ask questions. And a lot of those questions you should probably ask yourself. Think to yourself why something is the way that it is and see if you can come up with the answer. And you know, maybe you all can help each other in the comments if you maybe know the answer to something that somebody else is asking. But really that's what can help you with this course, is being curious and with life in general, to be honest. So let's get into it. The first question we should ask is, what is thermodynamics? You know, thermodynamics can be broken down into two parts, right? Thermo and dynamics, right? So, and I recently found this out, this actually derives from Greek, right? The etymology. Forgive me for my pronunciation, but therme and dynamis. And therme means heat, and dynamis means power or energy. And really what it is that thermodynamics is the study of energy, right? And you know, you have energy in different forms, which is why you saw that heat and power thing, because a lot of what they were doing back then was focused on trying to convert heat into different forms of energy. But thermodynamics is simply the study of energy, or power, I guess, if you will. Now, there are a few laws associated with thermodynamics, and we're going to talk about the first law first, right? And this is to do with the conservation of energy. And, you know, basically, we denote energy in thermo with a capital U. And if you see me write it, it would be something like this, and I would have two lines on top of that to emphasize that it's a capital. And that's very important, right? You don't want to confuse your lowercase letters and your uppercase letters in this course, because an uppercase U and a lowercase U mean two different things, and you'll see what I mean as time goes on. We have these things called specifics, right? So specific volume, specific energy, things like that. So all of that becomes very important down the line. The second law is entropy, and we denote entropy with an S, right? So an S, again, I would have my lines there to emphasize that it's a capital S. And essentially, you can define entropy as, I've heard it referred to as the level of disorderliness of a system, or the level of chaos of a system, right? And I've heard people dispute that kind of, but I think for our purposes, I think it's okay to look at it like that, the level of disorderliness of a system, or the level of chaos. Which brings us into the third law. And the third law is also about entropy, but it's kind of giving a quantitative value to entropy. So essentially, you know, we start talking about things like absolute zero, and that becomes relevant there. So hopefully it'll make quite a bit of sense down the line. And there's another law, a special law, the zeroth law. And so why didn't I talk about the zeroth law first if it's a zero, right? Well, actually, they had discovered the first three laws, and then they discovered the zeroth law. And what the zeroth law talks about is temperature, and we can denote that with a capital T. So it's called the zeroth law because it serves as like a fundamental for the other laws, if that makes sense. So that's why they called it the zeroth law. And that's why you saw me discuss it 1, 2, 3, and then zero, right? So that's what that is. Now I want us to get into some definitions, right? Now I'm gonna put this book to the side and don't judge me. Yes, I drink Mountain Dew from time to time. But the more important thing is that we're gonna talk about systems now. And what is a system? A system is anything we want it to be, right? And what I mean by that is that when we want to do some, you know, analysis on a system, it helps to be able to know what we're dealing with. So if I want to take what's inside this Mountain Dew can as my system, right, the mass inside of it is my system. And this denotes a closed system. But how do I know where my system stops? That's where my boundary comes into play. And my boundary is a line that denotes what's my system from what's outside of my system, which I can refer to as the environment or the surroundings or whatever, right? So the boundary is this infinitely thin line that doesn't have volume, it doesn't have mass. It's just something for us to know what is separating our system from our surroundings, if that makes sense. So a closed system, as this Mountain Dew can I pour any of the liquid out right now? No. So a closed system does not allow the transfer of mass across its boundary. But if I took a lighter to this, right, I could warm up the liquid inside, right? Because I can transfer heat across the boundary. I can also transfer work across the boundary. So that's what makes this a closed system. I can't transfer mass, but I can transfer heat and I can transfer work across the boundary, right? Cool. And I guess work getting transferred across the boundary, you can see how I can like kind of squeeze this can. I believe that's an example of me transferring work across the boundary. The reason I think that is because piston cylinders, which we will talk about in this course, you're kind of compressing a closed system. So you'll see what I mean. But that's kind of what I mean by you're able to connect different concepts, right? Now an open system, what happens if I do this? Now, if I want to pour out the Mountain Dew out of this can, will it pour out? Yes, it will. So an open system allows the transfer of mass along its boundary. But how do I know what the boundary is now? So because it's an open system that we're dealing with, yes, there's a hole here now, right, that can allow mass to transfer. So is there any point? There might be a point, but what for our purposes, right, I don't want to have to follow all of the mass as it's going outside of the system necessarily, right? We deal with some ideal situations in this course. So essentially, what I'm going to do is my boundary now, and it covers that line, right? So my boundary, I might take it as a control volume rather than a control mass, right? So mass can flow across my boundary. So now, because it's an open system, can I still heat it up? Yes. Can I still do work on the system? Yes, right? So an open system allows the transfer of mass, heat, and work across its boundaries, right? So this is an example of an open system because I can pour this out. And there's another special case. We're going to talk about an isolated system. An isolated system is simply a special system in which we don't allow energy transfer across our boundaries. So just take it as that for now. We're gonna go ahead and stop here, but I hope that was a pretty concise and understandable explanation of what we're dealing with, right? Just a little bit of an introduction. We have a closed system, an open system, isolated system, boundary, environment. Try to familiarize yourself with these things and try to connect these concepts to maybe your daily life as you're walking. Oh, what would that, if I wanted to observe that system, what would my boundary be? What would my environment be? What would my system be, right? So I hope this helps. As always, if you have any questions or anything, please feel free to leave them in the comments. If you have any comments or anything that you'd like to see me talk about, go ahead and say that. And thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.